All right, what is this? What are we doing here?
I don't know. You tell me.
We're talking about convergence.
Okay, that's right.
The last day today. Did you need to be reminded? I guess I need to be reminded.
Yes.
The last day of convergence, day four, Sunday.
Yes.
Sunday.
Fun day?
Sunday.
Oh.
I just wanted to say Sunday three times.
Oh, okay.
Like a monster truck announcer. yeah, the last day of convergence, you know, Sunday last day is always a little bittersweet.
Yes.
And by bittersweet, I mean lots of people pull it. Where do you get those canvas of human trailers that they have? Do you know what are those things
human
called?
Human trailers?
You always see these. People either have, so, you know, the old days, you get the Tupperware containers.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. Or, you know, if you went to the dealer's room for comics or something like that, you've got the dolly.
Yeah.
Maybe if you're really into it, the industrial dolly, mm-hmm. but like the luggage dolly.
Yes.
And then you got your long boxes up on there.
Yeah.
But something I see a lot for people that stay in the hotel is they come down and they've got suitcases and stuff, but they've also got this, it's like a wagon, right? It's probably like, you know, 3.5-4 feet long, and they just put all their, you know, stuff in there. So stuff that they've bought, or like if they got snacks and drinks and things like that, and it sort of like zips up. You'd be like, it's like an extra big duffel bag. We walked by like 50 of these.
I didn't notice them.
Okay, all right.
I'm going to be completely honest. She's...
She's got luggage blindness.
Yeah. Not paying attention to it.
Anyway, so you're seeing a lot of those.
Yeah.
You're seeing a lot of people saying goodbye to each other.
Yes.
A single tear in Deadpool's eye.
Yes.
If Deadpool or Spider-Man, or both, cries, does the tear come out of the mask? Or does it get wet on the inside? You know what? Inside.
Inside?
Everything about Spider-Man's costume is inconvenient for him because that's part of his superhero thing.
Yeah.
And so he's got to like pull the mouth up to eat.
Yeah, you're right.
People, he can't fight. He can't team up with Echo because she doesn't know what he's saying because
his mouth's covered.
Yeah, because she can't lip read him.
Yeah.
You know,
no, you're right.
It shrinks in the wash.
Yes.
Yeah. So
he got pain in it this last movie, and they spent like a couple of scenes. I was like, he is still trying to get that like fluorescent green paint off, and it's like, dude, Peter. And then like, then we just have one line where he says to Aunt May, "Thanks for cleaning my suit," and it's like, what? You were struggling with that for a long time.
Here's why you're wrong.
Hmm.
Because
why am I wrong?
Familiar?
Yes.
All right. We're getting ahead of ourselves. Do you want to talk about what we did today?
Yeah. So bright and early at the time of 9:30 a.m.
The crack of 9:30 a.m.
Yeah. I was talking about The Batman, which was a fun panel. I thought we had a lot of fun talking about the film and its influences, what we think maybe could be happening next, and that sort of thing. I guess somebody heard that Matt Reeves wants to have Mr. Freeze be the next bad guy, which could be really interesting, seeing him, Mr. Freeze, in like this dark, gritty, more based in reality Batman world. So I'd be interested to see how they do that. It wouldn't be a silver, you know, Arnold suit. So
you call it Batman Black Ice.
Yeah, right. So
it's really slick.
It's really slick.
This Mr. Freeze throws snowballs with gravel in them at
Whoa.
You.
Whoa.
That's what we did back in the old,
cuts your
the
face.
Old neighborhood. Yeah.
Oh my gosh.
Is this the Bat? Well, first of all, is the Batman in the main DCU world continuity?
I've heard that he is not.
Yeah, me too.
But that actually didn't come up in the panel today.
Because originally, I don't know, nobody knows what DC's doing, but I don't know that it was always assumed that it was going to be one of their boutique films.
Yeah.
But once Joker made $1 billion, I think they were like, oh, we can just do these side films that don't need to be connected.
And I think
but
that's
they love, you know, I do too, but they love connecting things.
They do love connecting things.
So what if, well, wrong company, Suppose This. What if DC had a comic name, Suppose This?
Oh, it would be really eye-rolly. Dan Didio's
last attack on the audience.
Yeah.
And they connect Joker to the Batman. This
I hate
is the
it.
Same gritty world.
I hate it. Thanks, I hate it. I like Barry Keogh as the Joker.
Right, but he's like the son of Joaquin Phoenix or something like that. That's the silence
I
of hate.
I really don't love it. That's the silence of hate. I really hate it. I cannot.
All right. Well, think about your hate. I'll think about my love. I really enjoyed the panel. I thought that it was great. And former guest, friend of the show, Chris Carter showed up on the panel.
Yes.
Because I think that he kind of last minute found out that he could come to the show. And so he was there.
Yes.
And it was really great to be like, talk about your love of Batman. Oh boy, I love Batman. I've seen all the movies. Man, I really love Batman. I've seen the cartoons and the comics are great. He's like, I wrote the music for all the Batman cartoons.
I know.
It's like, oh geez, okay, great. We've got somebody here.
How can I compete with this? Yeah,
I'm gonna leave.
I was
just
trying to
just get up, just sit down in the audience.
I know, right? I kind of felt bad. Like there's a small part of me that felt bad. Like, I wish there were more people in the audience specifically because of that. But I don't feel like the panels were overall really well attended this year.
In general?
In general. I feel like they've been better attended in the past. And I don't know if – I do feel like – you know, whoever is coming to Convergence. Did you hear a final count? Like, I think last night we were talking about 3,600 or
under. I'll research that while you finish your thought.
So I don't know how many of us there really were, but I feel like the people who came, maybe just a lot, the vast majority of them, or don't really go seek panels out. You know, because I feel like it was a lot of the same people who were attending the panels. It just wasn't very many people attending the panels, if that makes sense.
It's hard for me to tell because I just figure that, like, the subject of my panel is something too fringe for a big audience.
Yeah, but we're talking about, like, Star Trek and the Batman and,
to be fair, there were a lot of... Look, in some years past, the only Star Trek... Because I remember the before times, before Discovery, mm-hmm. and the only Star Trek panels were the ones that I suggested and went on, and then I was on them and people came. Or in the past when I modded some of the Marvel things, like the Civil War panel was packed. It was standing room only.
Yes,
but that was like the height of, you know, Marvel's first phases or whatever, and no COVID. So,
yeah, no COVID. I think that's a big thing.
Yeah, honestly. So it's just hard to know. I didn't think it was that bad, but that's interesting that that you observed that. I'll tell you, there was one particular person in attendance at your panel who asked a question. You might recognize, devastatingly handsome audience member who
I had a feeling this is where
who
you're
wanted
going.
To what? Who wanted to ask a question about the relationship between Batman and his villains, and specifically the Riddler in the Batman,
mm-hmm.
because you see this, there's this theory that, like, Batman kind of creates the villains, or at least encourages them, and you get, you know, almost all iterations of the Joker are, you know, in love with the Batman, or see themselves as a competition for the Batman, or the opposite number of the Batman.
Right.
And in the Batman, this is getting confusing, a lot of articles.
Yes, yes.
The Riddler, literally, he thinks that they're working together.
He's
deluded.
Yes.
And he thinks they're partners.
Mm-hmm.
And it's, and then he's like completely broken when the Batman's like, what are you talking about? We're not partners.
Yeah.
Like, the Riddler is the son of Sam and Batman is his dog.
Yeah.
You know, he thinks he's talking to him.
Right.
And so I wanted to know, like, what you guys thought about that connection, and if they will continue to sort of do that as they go forward. Like, is the Batman positive? Now, something that you guys didn't say, let me correct this panel. Well, you just didn't get to it.
Wow.
Was that I think that the film leans heavily on that idea.
Yeah,
because the Riddler is literally copycatting the Batman. But the Batman, the lesson that he learns is that he might be somebody who inspires other weirdos to do stuff, but he needs to be somebody who inspires regular people to do stuff.
He needs to be more. Something he realizes, one thing that I like about this is he starts off at the beginning and they're like, who are you? And he's like, I am vengeance. But then by the end of the film, one of Riddler's goons who is dressed like the Riddler says the same thing.
Right.
And I think it took that specific moment and all of the other things that he went through throughout the course of the film for him to be like, oh, okay. I was going too hard down the wrong path here. I need to double back and be the light and be hope for people.
Yeah.
And you literally see him reaching out the hand to the mayor, his hand to the mayor, and helping to rescue people.
Yeah.
And stuff like that. It can't just be about fighting.
I think
beating
he reached
up bad guys in an alley.
Out and booped her nose because it was really on the nose.
It
but
was
sometimes
on
when
the
you
nose.
Make a movie that everybody on Earth has to like, you got to make sure everybody kind of gets it.
Yeah.
Another great point that was made, and I can't remember exactly who made it, but you guys talked about the more gritty world of the Batman in the Batman. God. And
it's a lot of buzz.
And the fact that, like, injuries are more real. And so you can't just bow, piff.
Yeah.
Bow, piff. Whatever you do, don't do it. Not even once. You can't just take all that damage and not have things happen. I think it was, is her name Charlotte?
Charlene. Yeah.
I think Charlene was made the point that it's like, he gets hit in the head like 15 times just in his ninja training. So later on when he's like, and his entire thing is like punching people in the face. It's like, maybe we're seeing like some early CTE problems.
Yeah.
That's interesting. Yeah.
Yeah. And I think she also mentioned that, like, okay, so I will say the flight suit thing was cool, but he doesn't quite navigate that super well because that's where he hits his head. But seeing him mess up was kind of refreshing.
The Batman should have a regulation helmet. It should be like a football helmet.
Yeah.
You just glue ears on top.
Yes, I agree.
That's what you do.
Yeah. I think that would be perfect.
The warm body count for Convergence this year was 3,437 attendees.
Oh, okay. All right. Wow. So it was less than we thought. Just a little bit.
Well, I said 36.
Yeah. I mean, that's a pretty good estimate. Okay. I think that was around, I think we talked about it earlier. I think that we had around the same last year when there was a cap or a lower cap. And this year, there at the very least, was a higher cap. So I think we're just seeing a lot of people still being really cautious and not wanting to come out because of COVID.
Yeah.
Which I understand and can appreciate.
It was announced also that the dates for Convergence next year will be July 6th through 9th.
Yeah,
2023.
They're going back to. I knew it was going to go back to 4th of July weekend. Eventually, they just couldn't get it for the first couple years we were at the hotel. So I think we'll probably have 4th of July weekend most of the time moving forward now. I don't know. I was okay with it actually moving to August once it actually moved to August. So now that it's moving back to July 4th, I guess it doesn't really matter to me either way. It doesn't ruin my July 4th plans. I never had July 4th plans. So it's fine.
What else did we get up to?
Sorry, it's fine.
Still flipping through these updates.
My next panel was...
For my next panel,
I pulled out of the hat a Spider-Man No Way Home panel. It was... I think it went okay for the most part. Most of the people on the panel were pretty pumped about Spider-Man and really liked the movie a lot. I think I was, as far as I know, the only one who really liked seeing it in the theater, but upon seeing it the second time, felt like it was a little fan service-y and a little, I didn't enjoy it as much seeing it the second time after the glow was off.
And that was well received.
No.
Oh.
I don't, well, I think it was, I don't think that that particularly was horribly received. I just don't think that it was well received. You know,
well, you were respectful,
yeah,
about the fact that you didn't love the entire thing,
of course. And I always try to, I try to be very positive, especially after, I don't know. I had an experience a couple of convergences ago when I was on a Ms. Marvel panel, and it was a panel I had suggested, and I had realized after doing it, you know, if you don't really like something, you shouldn't suggest talking about it, because people just want to squee, you know.
Yeah, well, and that's, I mean, that's the big that's the big question, isn't it? The big conflict of a panel. Are we here to squee about it, or are we here,
to talk about it?
And yeah, talking about it might mean that we talk about things that we thought could have been improved or better.
Yeah, and I think that that's fine.
Yeah, well, was the description like, come talk about the best Air Force recruitment film there's ever been, Ms. Marvel?
It wasn't. And so, I mean, I guess I should have learned my lesson, because I suggested this panel too. I liked Spider-Man No Way Home more as a film than Ms. Marvel as a film.
I'd flip those.
Really?
Yeah.
I don't love it. It's not A plus for me. It sits more like a B minus C. You know, like I think when I saw it initially in the theater, it was my favorite film from last year. And honestly, there were a lot of not so great films. So it still might be my favorite film from 2021, honestly.
Okay.
But I don't know. It just wasn't my favorite, and I didn't feel like my comments were always well received on the panel, which is a little unfortunate. So, but yeah.
Spider-Man's crying. Inside of his mask is wet.
The inside of his mask, yes.
We always release shows on Sunday or yes, Monday morning. And so what we forgot to do is introduce ourselves. This is sort of a combination of our weekly show and the fourth and final wrap-up show for Convergence. So
yes,
I guess I'll just say here, we're the Just Enough Trope podcast. I'm your host, Caliban, joined as always by my co-host.
Hi, I'm Mikan Hanna.
And we're here to bring you all the news that's fit to cast in the world of nerdy entertainment, but also the world of Convergence.
Yes.
There. It's like NPR. We have to, you know. Great point. Let me stop there for a second. Just say, this is All Things Considered on NPR. Okay, go ahead.
Yeah, right, exactly.
It's very annoying. It's Neil Conan.
I wish he didn't have to do that. No, I'm kidding.
Neil, you're an asshole. No, I don't know if that's true. Neil Conan's probably a really nice guy.
Probably.
Okay, so yes, two panels complete.
Yes.
I had one panel.
Yes.
Today.
Yes.
The last panel.
The last panel you'll ever need.
But it was also one of the last panels.
It was.
3:30 p.m. Mm-hmm. Sunday afternoon.
Yes.
While drums and dancing and disco music and taikos and a lot of stuff going on over at Main Stage.
Yeah.
But here we are.
Yeah.
In this room.
Yeah.
Talking about Quantum Leap.
Yes.
I've locked the doors. Scream your head off. No one will hear you. And I was a little worried that nobody would come to a panel about a 30-year-old show, NBC show, at the very last panel slot of Con.
Right.
But great turnout.
Mm-hmm.
Great panel.
Mm-hmm.
Two great people with me talking about Quantum Leap. I do not feel like I wasted 97 hours of my life rewatching the series for that panel.
Good. Good.
We had a lot to talk about. It's a complicated series.
It is.
And I was trying to both moderate but also gauge the age range of the attendees of the panel. Because I was like, who likes Quantum? I like Quantum Leap because I was a teenager when it came out.
Mm-hmm.
And it was a time travel show about a guy, a do-gooder, righting wrongs and hanging out with JFK or something. I don't know.
Yeah, right.
And so, like, that was right up my alley.
Mm-hmm.
But, like, what does a 25-year-old get out of this? Like, what does, you know, somebody, a 20-year-old, what would a Gen Zer get out of this, if anything?
Yeah.
And I don't know if we answered that.
No,
but I think that we did determine that it's kind of an evergreen premise. The idea that this guy travels through time.
Yeah.
And in doing so, explores social issues of the American experience.
Yes.
So universal that they're bringing it back. Speaking of universal, this September, a new series described in some corners as a sixth season of Quantum Leap will be premiering with an all new main character and a new team of people and hopefully a broader scope. When it comes to examining those social issues.
I didn't mention this
in the panel, and I should have, but it's kind of like time-traveling Star Trek.
Yeah.
Without the metaphors.
Yeah.
Star Trek goes to a planet, people are black on one side, white on the other, and vice versa, and they go, you guys just got to get along.
Right.
Sam Beckett leaps back to Georgia, 1958.
Yeah.
And he's like, oh boy, you guys got to get along.
Yeah, right. Exactly.
And so it's, yeah, they're. I think one of the reasons that I like them is obviously I like Star Trek too. They are similar in that way. And so I hope that continues.
Yeah.
And Scott, one of the guys in the panel, voiced a concern that it would not continue and that it would be focused more on the sci-fi elements and explosions and action. You know, we got a sort of really brief kind of visual teaser that no real dialogue. So it's hard to determine.
I haven't even seen that. So
That is just like zap, zap. And like, you know,
I hope that's special effects.
And so I hope that that's just a sort of sizzler or sizzle reel. And it is a little more thoughtful. I don't see how it can't be without totally betraying.
It would just be a totally different show.
Yeah.
It would just have a different heart to it. So
I'm looking forward to that. I'm not super jazzed that it's only on Peacock. It's not a broadcast show.
Mm.
I don't think that precludes it being a success, but we will definitely be exposed to less people.
Yeah, I think that's the thing.
But if the bar for success and continuance is lower, then, you know, if we nerds get together, we can make this thing a success online.
Sure.
So I hope people check it out. And I want to say thanks to the people that are on the panel. And it was a good time.
Yeah.
It was worth it.
It was a good time.
And as soon as it was over.
Yes. I know, exactly.
And I came back in and I was on top of a diving board. And I was like, oh boy.
You always have to say, oh boy. That's what you're contractually obligated to say.
That's going to be part of the new show. It has to be.
It has to be.
Yeah.
Or they're going to give him a new catchphrase. What do you think it would be?
What the fuck?
Oh man, I better not be that.
Oh, what day is it? What? September 11th, 2001.
Yeah.
What the I like how I was just calling out to somebody what day it was. Like I'm Ebenezer Scrooge.
Yes.
In Midtown Manhattan.
Yeah.
On September the 11th, 2001. Open up the window of my skyscraper.
What day is today?
Yeah. You there, tourist taking a picture of Superman in Times Square. What day is it? And Eminem looks up and says, why, sir? It's Tuesday.
Oh, my gosh.
Right.
Terrible.
Terrible. Awful.
I grew up watching Quantum Leap. I watched Quantum Leap and Next Generation with my parents. So those are the shows that I really remember watching growing up. Those and Murder, She Wrote. Those three. Those are the ones I remember
watching
the most.
Someday I'll, I guess, get into Murder, She Wrote. I have to get into Columbo right now.
Okay.
Because Columbo... I also watched with my parents, and it is you know, Columbo, the productions of Columbo span, you know, a couple different decades.
Okay.
But, you know, in the sweet spot of the 70s or whatever, and even in later in the 80s and 90s, there's a lot of guest stars, you know, TV guest stars.
Yeah.
So William Shatner comes through. James Doohan comes through. A lot of Star Trek guys come through. So I have to watch for that reason.
Gotcha.
So yeah, that was the programming side of our day. Mm-hmm. It's pretty much all we really got to do. Although we did enjoy some lovely fish and chips.
We did.
At a Brit's pub.
Yeah. And we did go through the dealer's room.
Yes.
We kind of zoomed through.
You tried to talk me into a articulated dragon.
I just and think I said nope.
No. Why do you do that?
I think they're neat.
Why do you do that?
I just think they're neat. I just think they're neat.
Hold on. I got a meme to make.
Yeah. Okay.
What's the name of the company so I can steal the art?
I don't remember the name of the company.
We'll figure it out later.
So.
Here's something we figured out. The theme for next year is all dressed up.
Yes.
A focus on cosplay. So I've been looking for an excuse to, first of all, get my abs back because I'm vain. So look out for a lot of, we need to buy nipple pasties right now.
Oh my God, no.
Or I'll do a lot of half shirt cosplays.
Oh my gosh.
Was it Vi? What about a Rule 34 Vi?
What?
Or wait, no, Rule 34. Is that the sex one?
I don't know what you're talking about. I have no idea what you're talking about.
What's the, where they flip the gender? 36? What are the rules?
I don't.
Today at the panel, they said, there was that episode where Sam becomes a vampire, and they talked about the legend of Count Bathory.
Yes.
And Renata was making a point about how, like, but it's Lady Bathory. And
yes.
I was like, oh, no, they rule 34 at Lady Bathory.
Uh-huh.
Rule 34 is that if it exists, there's porn on the internet of it.
Oh, so you said the wrong number.
Well, nobody corrected me. So whose fault is that?
I didn't get it.
Anyway, my Rule 34 cosplay, it's going to be pretty good.
Oh, my God.
No, I want to be a male version of V.I., the redheaded character from Arcane. There's Powder and V.
Yeah.
Oh, it's just V?
Or Vi. It's Vi. It's Vi.
They don't say her name a lot, in my defense.
Yeah. That'd be cool.
Because then I can get the abs out.
Oh, I see what you're
But anyway, saying. We haven't seriously cosplayed in like 5 years, and so it's time to get back on the wagon.
I like cosplaying. It just costs so much.
It's
so expensive.
We dug through so many Axe Men. Are they Axe Men or Axe Mans?
I don't think it has to cost that much.
And you can always do a closet cosplay, or as I and no one else calls it, clawsplay. Hashtag.
Oh my God.
Just do that. She's thinking about money. Visions of burning dollar bills are in her head right now.
Mm-hmm.
So, anyway, any last thoughts about CONvergence before we say goodbye for this year of our Lord, 2022?
I think that the panels went well. I wish that they were more attended, but there's nothing we can do about that.
I wish I got to attend more.
Yeah.
I was doing a lot of work, and so...
So, I don't know. I always feel like there's things that we could do different or better, like, next time. Like, I didn't actually get to see the art auction, so I wish I could have gone and seen that.
Yeah.
So, I always feel bittersweet when it ends, and, I guess I'll have to start thinking about saving up money now.
She's going catatonic.
I'm sorry. I'm still thinking about how expensive it's going to be.
I'm glad.
The thing is, I want to be what I want to be, you know? The
finances.
So, anyways.
If you want to lighten Mika's mood, we have a Patreon at patreon.com/justenoughtrope. Where you can become a producer for the show. One of the things the producers get to do is pick our topic for our patron show.
Mm-hmm.
At the end of every month, we do a show where the patrons pick the P word. Didn't come out perfectly. Peter Pecker picked a pack of pickled patrons. And
the patrons pick the picture.
We pick a...
There we go. Because they pick the
Look,
film.
We've been talking all weekend.
Yeah.
Everybody talked out. Okay. We recorded a show before this. And so they get to pick the picture.
Mm-hmm.
It's not always a movie, but it's been recently a movie where we pick a topic and we get to pick... you get to pick what we talk about.
Mm-hmm.
And it isn't always punishing... But sometimes not always. Sometimes the choices are two things. It's like the lesser of two evils. And so if you want to torture us a little bit, get some value for your dollar. That's the way to do it. Become a producer of the show at patreon.com/justenoughtrope. Mm-hmm. Something else that we do on this show is talk about the news. And I wanted to look very quickly at some news. I got a good story. I got a bad story. Which one do you want first?
Hit me with the good.
You want the good first? People always take the bad first, usually.
You asked me.
Oh, okay. All right. Here's the good story. Did you know, you must have known, that Sony Pictures is related to Sony video games?
Sure.
It's not a coincidence. I know it's a common name, but it's not a coincidence.
Right.
And for a little while now, Sony has had designs on a MCU-type universe for their properties at the Cineplex.
Okay.
Early shot in that war was the Uncharted film.
Yeah.
A film no one asked for, but we got anyway.
Yep.
And
oh, Sony.
Well, you know, you gotta dance with the girl you brought.
Uh-huh.
Or boy.
Yes.
And so they're doing that. I'm not sure where we're at in terms of who owns Tomb Raider now.
I don't think we've talked about this before.
It's
and I
kind
don't
of the house that Sony built, but I don't think they're connected to that. But anyway, they're looking to make some of their properties into games. And one of those things is the very popular Ghost of Tsushima game that came out.
Oh, they're
a couple
making
years
it into
ago.
A film?
There will be a film.
Oh, okay.
That is correct. Oh, of course, The Last of Us TV show, which will be on HBO, but is produced by Sony. And the rumor is that the entire film will be in Japanese.
Oh, that is good.
That's good. That's good.
I think that has the potential to be really good because the game is very cinematic.
Yes.
And I think would lend itself really well to film. And I think that people who are fans of the game would come out and support a film too.
Well, it's certainly, you know, if you, this is an old piece of news, but video games make more than movies now. And so it would probably be smart, although we all know that video games have kind of a spotty track record when being turned into films.
Yeah.
See Uncharted 2021. Mm-hmm. But it would be smart to sort of entice that audience to come to the to the thing. Of course, you're competing directly. Get them off the couch in the first place.
Yeah.
Why would I go see Tomb Raider when I can play Tomb Raider?
Right.
This will be directed by Chad Stahelski, one of the directors of John Wick.
Okay.
And so it's his idea. He says, yeah, I'll just be make it subtitle. People will watch it. It's good.
Okay, dude. Let's see it through all the way and do it. Make all the right choices. That's what I say.
I don't think that he has enough power to make that decision.
Yeah.
I would agree that it would be cool if it happened, but I can see the studio going, we're not going to do that. However, of course, in 2020, Parasite by Bong Joon-ho won Best Picture.
Yeah.
First Asian foreign language one, for sure.
Yes.
For a subtitled film, I believe.
Yeah.
And so do you think that signals a receptibility to subtitled foreign language films, specifically films from the Asian sphere?
Because
that would be good news for Tsushima.
Yeah, I think that it does. And I think that also with... oh my gosh, I can't remember the name of it now. Help me out here. The Netflix Korean show that was really popular.
Squid Game.
Squid Game, thank you. I think with the popularity of that as well, like that was one of the most popular shows on Netflix and just did amazingly well. So I think... we are learning that people will actually watch something with subtitles, and that doesn't deter people. So I think that is good news.
Yeah.
And specifically something that is Asian. So
I think that it could – it's a good story in the game. I think it could make a great movie, better than a game because it's kind of crap as a game, at least in terms of the story. They try to introduce. It's a, like a movie that you play, which is good for some games, but they try to pretend like you have choices, and you don't really. And so I think that it would have been, the game would have been better if they just let you do what you do and just had you watch cutscenes and sort of, you know, not pretend like you're kind of picking
your path, you know,
whether you're honorable or dishonorable.
Sure.
And of course that'll be fixed in a movie because, as of yet, we don't have Choose Your Own Adventure movies.
No.
Unless you pick what theater you see Clue in. Now, okay. That's for the old heads.
Okay.
Remember Clue?
Yeah, I remember
had
Clue.
Had multiple endings.
Oh, I forgot that it had multiple endings.
They shipped
endings.
Them sort of randomly to theaters, so oh. Depending on where you saw it, it had a...
I don't know if I've seen all the endings to Clue then. Huh. Interesting. Okay, now I have to look into that.
Well, you wanted the bad news second.
Yes.
Here it is. Anne Heche has passed away at the age of 53.
Yep.
She was in this car accident that was very serious and fell into a coma and was declared, you know, essentially dead, brain dead.
Brain dead, yeah.
Okay. And tonight she's was recently taken off of life support.
Okay.
They'd kept her on because she was a donor, and so they were, you know, evaluating her as a... As an organ donor. So
wow.
They do that.
Okay.
Yeah, not great. And, you know, it's just, it's sad and it's sudden. And
it's
very
sudden.
I don't know if she was anybody's favorite actress. But, you know, she certainly had an interesting body of work. I remember watching her in Another World.
Mm.
Where she played twins. Vicky and Marley. In my soap opera phase.
Oh, wow.
When I was 12. don't ask me to explain.
I remember when she dated Ellen DeGeneres
and she was in Donnie Brasco, which is a pretty good movie. And had kind of like a later career resurgence where she was in a lot of movies and TV. She also was a voice actress. She was in The Legend of Korra.
Oh, I didn't know that.
Yeah, and so was somebody who was had a tough upbringing and kind of a rocky sort of life and career, but
she
looked like everything was going good.
A lot of things that she was going through, feel like, in her life, throughout her life. A lot of, like, mental health stuff and just seemed like she wasn't always getting what she needed to get for help. But it seemed like she was...
But she was an advocate for that, though.
It seemed like she was doing better. And so it's just... She's fairly young, and it's really sad.
Yeah.
It's just really sad. To go that suddenly. I mean, people get in car crashes, you know, and there's just nothing you can do. So my heart goes out to her family. It's got to be incredibly difficult, I think. I don't know. I always think that, like, if somebody's sick, it's still sad when they die, you know. But then I feel like you have time to prepare yourself for, like, they're not going to be around for that much longer. And you can savor those moments.
Yeah.
When somebody goes this quickly, you don't have that.
Yeah.
So.
Yeah. And her, you know, her adult children were, you know, saying that exact thing, basically, recently. But, it's too bad. Normally we try to find a way to get out of the news.
I'm sorry.
A little cheerier.
If you told me it was a death, I would have gone for that.
It's always
first.
A death. Listen to our past shows. They're dropping like flies. There's a bunch of B and C listers I'm not even talking about.
Yeah, I know.
People are always dying.
I know.
Ah.
Sorry, you sound a little bit like Seinfeld there. People are always dying.
Yeah, not his best special.
No.
Well, let's move to something that is good news, and that is a good movie, a movie that came out just recently on Hulu.
Mm-hmm.
The movie's called Prey.
Yes.
Now, I don't know if you have figured this out, but this is a movie that's part of the Predator franchise.
Yes.
You see, the franchise is called Predator.
Mm-hmm.
This movie, this is called Prey.
Right.
It's directed by Dan Trachtenberg,
mm-hmm.
the famous director of all kinds of films.
Okay. I feel the sarcasm.
Specifically, 10 Cloverfield Lane.
Uh-huh.
That is all.
Yes.
That's it.
Okay.
This is the second movie. Now, 10 Cloverfield, did you see that?
No.
I didn't either, but I've heard good things.
Mm-hmm.
He also directed an episode of Black Mirror, an episode of The Boys. And an episode of The Lost Symbol. Dan Brown's The Lost Symbol.
Oh, okay.
So just getting his start here.
Okay.
He famously got his start with a short film called Portal No Escape, which I've seen. It's basically, it's like dramatizing what happens in the game Portal.
I was going to ask if that's what it was.
That's exactly what it is.
Oh my God. Kind of leans of video games as in a film.
Yeah, it leans on this, the special effects, the sort of the physics of the portal and the portal gun. And it was very interesting. Kind of got him noticed, and he eventually got to direct a couple more short films. He directed a film recently based on the game Warframe.
Okay.
A short film, which is a popular online game. And we got it. He's a big white guy.
Mm-hmm.
I don't know what you want.
Yeah.
We're still doing that.
Yeah.
But it's not his fault that he's a big white guy.
Yeah.
What'd you think of the film? Actually, wait. No. Here's what we do. What happens in Prey?
God. I was not prepared for this. What? You're looking at me like
I'm not looking at you
be...
at all.
Yeah.
I'm looking at the synopsis so I can check your facts.
Oh my God. So it's like in the 1700s in America on the Great Plains, and we focus on a Native American tribe, and I'm gonna be terrible remembering everybody's names. The main character's name is Naru, and I remember that because that's the name of a character in Sailor Moon.
Right.
And she's got a dog, and he's very cute. That's very important to the story. Anyways.
Pake is her dog, I think?
I can't remember what the dog's name is.
Yeah.
Or is it a girl? No, I can't remember if it's a girl or a boy.
No, it's not Pake. I don't know if the dog has a name.
Okay. But the dog is very cute. Anyways, she wants, the main thrust is she wants to be a hunter. And nobody's taking her seriously to be a hunter. It's not really established if girls do or do not hunt, but this is what she wants to do.
Good setup. We're ready for the synopsis.
Yeah. Okay. And she sees some lights in the skies. And so Predator, like one of the Predators, like comes to Earth to do some hunting. And they think they're tracking a mountain lion at first, and she is actually, she's very smart, and she picks up on this is not just a mountain lion. There's something else out there because it, like, skinned a snake in, like, one go, and what does that? And so she's very, and there's...
A mountain lion with a hunting knife?
Yeah, right. And there's, like, lights in the sky and everything, too. So she has to... nobody believes her, and she has to go out and kind of prove herself and prove that she's a good hunter and prove that there's something else out there. And that's pretty much what it's about.
How over under on the amount of minutes you hear?
Yeah,
that sound in the movie.
A lot. You hear it a lot.
So this is a what would you call this? Sequel, spinoff, movie in the canon.
It's a twist. Spin-off? Yeah.
Sort of a stripped down reboot.
Yeah.
Can you see a Prey 2?
I could actually keep praying. A Prey 2.
Prey harder.
Yeah.
Prey harder second time too.
Oh my gosh.
Obviously Prey harder.
But yeah. They'd have to do something different, though. Like, maybe there'd have to be, like, multiple Predators or something. I don't know.
Yeah. Up in the stakes always works.
Yeah, right.
Okay. So, I'm running out of things to say to get around the fact that I didn't love this.
Uh-huh.
And I know now, come at me, entire internet, rest of panel. It's fine. It's fine.
Mm-hmm.
It's a good B.
Yeah.
But people are, like, crapping themselves and saying like it's the best thing ever. And like, I think the complete mess, but fun mess that is Predator 2 is like better than this.
Okay.
I like the things that everybody seems to like about it, which is its focus on a female character.
Mm-hmm.
Its focus on, you know, it's not like there are a million predators or we got bigger guns or it's in the future or it's Adrian Brody all looking ripped. I like the stripped down aspect of it. I like the fact that it is focusing on, you know, a native character.
I do too.
And, yeah. You know, I'll have to read an interview or something like that about like the accuracy. Not that, as long as it doesn't offend anybody, I guess it doesn't really matter. Do you know what I mean? Like,
yeah.
We take like, historical accuracy is important and cultural accuracy is important.
Yes.
But like, we take great offense when like, oh, it would be blue instead of red. And it's like, well, okay. But I mean, like they're doing the best that they can. This is not a Chakotay situation.
At
here.
Least everybody who plays a Native American is actually
Native American. They're all Native heritage. American. Right. Yeah. Yeah.
So that's a massive step.
But again,
the
they're
direction.
Not like Comanche. And so like, yeah, I'm just saying, not all of them don't anyways. Get mad about that. Like yeah. It's, there are certain realities when you have to shoot a movie, you know, with hundreds of people.
Yeah.
That being said, the star is really great. Amber Midthunder, you know, been tracking her since Legion, which she was really great on.
Mm-hmm.
And when I heard that she was going to be part of this, I thought, that's perfect. Like, she I think, could be a good action lead. And she does. She's great in this.
Mm-hmm.
I just think the movie's kind of silly. I think that it thinks that it's like, oh, this is serious stuff. This is real serious, and I don't think it's. I think it's kind of silly, and yeah. I think that a lot of things happen that are like super convenient. You know what I mean? Like, I like the idea of her not even having a gun. Do you know what I mean? Like, she's just and not even having like how did Dutch make all those? That log trap in the first Predator, was it vines or something like
probably.
That? Like, she's got like much lower technology. And so I like the idea of like getting this Predator, this guy into the kill box, you know what mm-hmm. I mean? And then using all the things on him. Like, that's fine. But, you know, there's a trap and she steps in a trap at the exact right time. And then there's the mud hole and there's a flower that you can eat that lowers your body temperature. So you're invisible to his infrared.
I know.
Like, he could just take his mask off and just go, there's a person right there. Just those little things that I think are screenwritery things. Cause you're like, oh, there's been six of these already. So I was like, oh yeah. So you get that thing, you know, Dutch put mud on, but she's not going to put mud on. She's going to eat the flower.
Yeah.
And then you'll be able to see her.
Right.
And that's like silly. And it's not when a sci-fi movie gets too into its own mythology and its own technology and forgets about like what's going on in the story.
Mm-hmm.
You know, we say that that's bad. And for me, like, ironically, there's like no technology. It's like lower technology.
Yeah.
I thought the little particulars were just a lot less interesting. I also liked, I don't want to give my entire review. I'll let you talk in a second. I also liked when she was kicking ass, but I thought she should have kicked a lot more ass.
Yes.
And a lot of people have complimented the movie on the idea that she doesn't have to be like a total ass kicker, and she's, you know, it's about that she thinks and she sees things. And I'm like, thinking and seeing things is fine, but like, she is a warrior of the plains who lives a hard scrabble existence. And she didn't just yesterday decide that she wanted to be a hunter. She's been training for this, and you get the impression that, I don't know if it's her society or just her community, because her older brother is the dude, has been holding her down.
Mm-hmm.
So like, yeah, you're building up a character and you're building up an arc for her that like every time she raises the axe, she sort of lowers it and runs away because this thing is just going creepy Jason and killing everybody.
Right.
But like, you know, you could have shown her like kicking a little more ass.
I think I would have preferred
because once she turns around, you know, in the second half of the movie, she goes ham on those voyageurs.
Yeah, I know. I think I would have preferred to see her do like a ramp up. Than like her get like scared and run away like as much as she did. I understand why they did it, but I think we could have seen more of her like being like planting her feet and being like, okay, if I, you know, more or less being like, if I want to be a warrior, I have to do this. I have to, you know, not saying this, but she has to like seeing her thinking, I have to face my fears.
Yeah.
You know? And we don't really get that, but I don't know. And then there's the progression of the predator, like, hunting. Like, I don't know how many times the predator has been to Earth. Maybe this is the first time. Maybe that's what we're supposed to get. But I don't know that we necessarily needed the predator progressively killing bigger, stronger, more deadlier animals.
Like, right. Like, what are we trying to tell us? Like, I assume that he flew from his planet light years away to hunt.
Yeah.
Not like, okay, so the thing with the fangs that chases after the soft furry thing, he's the predator.
Well, and it's like, just what? Like, it makes the predator seem dumb. You know?
He did seem dumb, and I thought his design his design was dumb.
Oh.
Sure, you don't want to do the same thing, the metal mask and everything, but like, are you trying to say that he's like a caveman predator?
They are aliens
from space with warp drive.
I thought they were trying to say like he was like a native, like lower technology.
Or was he?
Guy.
And they never talk. But like, or was he? Is this his like? What year is this? It's the 1700s. Okay, I'm gonna go with this
dress
outfit.
Down.
Yeah, right. Exactly. he's cosplaying.
I like the idea of that. I don't know.
It's
if
It's like
that's
in a video game. He's
for,
like, oh,
but...
I'm gonna go for the. I'm gonna wear the Santa suit for
yeah,
this one.
Yeah. Right. Right. Okay.
Let's talk about the Predator.
Yeah.
Here's what's scary about the Predator. You can't see him.
Yeah.
And he can blow your brains out with his little laser thing.
Yeah.
Here's what's not scary about the Predator. Him being a Ripley effect that kills like 40 guys.
Yeah.
It was like a Jason movie. It was like a later Jason movie where I'm supposed to get excited that he... throws a bear trap at a guy's head and explodes it. I mean, it's like, I'm sure he was like, oh man, this is going to go great on Predator YouTube. I'm going to get a lot of likes for this. But like, I don't know. I just thought it was kind of silly. I thought, you know,
you
the way that Jason like
more?
Crushes people's heads and like, you know, hits a camper against a tree in a sleeping bag. It's like, okay, that's Jason's thing. But like, what's he here to do? Like
He's
hunt as many
hunt.
Things as possible. He took like one spine. He's supposed to take all the spines and the skulls.
Yeah, I
At
know.
Some point, he just became like a movie monster who's like a implacable killer, and he's not there to follow a code or be honorable or something like that. You get the sense in better Predator movies that the movie could be Predator.
Mm-hmm.
He could be the main character
mm-hmm.
if he talked more and we were following him instead of Danny Glover or something like that.
Sure.
And so I thought that was kind of weird. Every character that shows up that isn't named Naru is there to die. And I thought that
yes.
was kind of weird. I mean, obviously there's a final girl thing or a final Austrian thing in the case of Predator.
Mm-hmm.
Although there is a girl in that too. And he just tears through them. And it's in uninteresting ways. So like when... what's Carl Weathers' character? Just Carl Weathers. Something you son of a bitch. I can't remember the guy's name.
I can't remember his name.
But anyway.
Yeah.
He dies when he's being very sneaky.
Yes.
He's under a log.
It's
and
very terrifying.
They're going to sneak and they're going to figure it out, right?
Mm-hmm.
Oh, no, wait. That's, sorry. That's Bill Duke's character.
Oh,
anyway.
Okay.
They all die in ways. The whole thing is about like, it's written by Shane Black, noted high octane masculine cokehead.
Yeah.
And yet it's a deconstruction of masculinity because the first half of the movie is this, you know, action scene where stick around and all this good stuff. And then they are just destroyed and they go nuts because they can't,
Bill,
really the Native American character, Billy, is just like,
yeah.
And he cuts his arm. He's like, come on, they get me.
Yes.
We don't see that guy anymore. He's gone.
No.
And so this didn't have that. I guess it had a kind of the flip side of that, which a tale of female empowerment.
Mm-hmm.
But all the characters are there and you just know they're all going to die. And there's a bunch of French voyageurs who are the dumbest guys ever.
Yep.
They shoot a million bullets at this thing. At some point you just go, sacre bleu, I'm out of here.
Yeah.
And even if you don't know what a future bomb is, there's like the three guys that see the bombs come up. And you're seeing floating magic bombs.
They just mesmerized by them.
Right. And because it's PG-13, maybe it's R. I'm not sure. It's probably R. But it's like a light R. We don't even get like a gory kill. We cut away.
Yeah.
And it's like comedic. Like if a guy goes, oh, is this a bomb? Wide shot. little explosion.
Yes.
That's a comedy beat.
It is a comedy beat.
Were you trying
beat.
To make You're me right. laugh, or are you trying to make me go, oh, this guy kills everybody?
Great question.
Yeah. It was confusing in that way.
I didn't think it was very scary.
Yeah.
I think that it could have been scarier. And
what
I
if
think
the Predator had a dog?
An alien dog?
Yeah.
Yeah, there you go.
You give the other dog something to do.
Oh, yeah.
He's got to fight an alien dog. Because at this point, even if he's got a different helmet on, we're not really going to be scared by the Predator because we kind of get
what the Predator is.
Yeah. I know it's, you know, you can do scary in the woods. Like if this was a building,
yes,
the Predator would be coming up the stairs and she's looking for a weapon or she's hiding or something like that. That's, you know, how we get scary. So I get that, like, the environment. I just didn't think they used the environment in a scary way.
No, and I think they could have used it a lot better. And I know that, like, you know, Naru is somebody who is, you know, really clever and really smart and knows the woods really well. But maybe we could have set something up about, like, oh, don't go over into this area. You know, like
all
this.
All that the light touches.
Yeah, right.
But not over there.
Like, this area is not necessarily haunted, but there's bad stuff happens there.
Interesting.
Or, you know.
Like, that is the area where the mud sinkholes are.
Sure.
Or there's a... Right. A lot of rattlesnakes over there.
And that might have been the case, but that was not clear if that's what was happening.
She's
you know,
gonna lead him in. Because the thing with, like, Predator is, it's not, we know what he's doing, right? He sets the trap up.
Mm-hmm.
He's like, come on, kill me, come on.
Yeah.
And they kind of reference that, you know, in this.
There are a lot of references in this.
Yeah. If it bleeds, we can kill it. It's like, oh, the old Comanche saying. But I mean, like, that's a saying, I suppose, anywhere.
Yeah.
So, like, yeah, like, recreating and mirroring those things is like, huh?
Yeah.
It reminded me of, we were talking about this. I don't think this was a panel, but how the Batman is, like, a really, and I'm going to say original, even though I guess I mean adapting Earth One, Grant Moore, or Geoff Johns' Earth One.
It combines a lot of different comics, but heavily Earth One, yeah.
But it is a original cinematic take on the Batman.
Yes.
With a bunch of stuff that clearly some DC suit was like, oh, I gotta put this in there.
Yeah.
And so it keeps like, it's gonna stop. We were chugging along on the bat cycle. We gotta stop. Red light. The Joker's in this.
Mm-hmm.
Oh, whoop, stop, red light. You know, mm-hmm. there's a reference to some other thing.
Yes.
And I thought that, like, if this didn't try to follow, like, references and follow, like, the shape of other movies, it would have been more interesting. But alas, that film does not exist. Mm-hmm. It's just we have this.
Mm-hmm.
Everybody on the panel hates us. I get it. We shouldn't have come to this panel.
I know. What I don't like is, like, realizing that while I'm on the panel. Oh, I'm the asshole.
I hate this movie. just pick up your mic and then drop it.
Yeah.
You weren't holding it.
Yeah, right. And
then you pick it up.
You pick it up.
So you can drop it.
Yeah. I'm leaving this panel
table.
Now.
Yeah.
Boom.
So anyway, that being said, I mean, I still like the movie. I really like it. I've only seen it once and I'm going to watch it again. And I would definitely recommend it.
I would recommend it too.
I look at other people who are laughing and jumping up and down and sharing candy and stuff. And I wish I could be with them. But some things bother me about the film.
I think they're doing that because it's very heavily...
Well, did you see the last one? It's a huge step forward
it's a huge improvement. Yeah. And it's a mostly Native American cast. And it's a female lead, and I think that's why people are excited about it.
What do you think about
this? And I'm excited about that, too.
Yeah. Did we spoil it? Look, it's a Predator movie. You know that a Predator hunts somebody, and they probably win against the Predator.
Yeah, right.
Here's a spoiler for the end of the credits. What do you think about the suggestion that the story is not done, and that maybe those Predators are like, I hear the hunting's really good on 17th century Earth. Just bring your snowshoes so you don't fall in some mud and your water wings.
I saw all those YouTube videos from my boy yeah. killing stuff. Yeah.
Translated. Hey, what's up? It's your boy, the Predator. Yeah. Maybe we'll get a thing where I think all the like Braves and the tribe are dead, but like maybe we'll get a thing where she becomes, you know, as the war chief, she not only is kicking ass, but she's also having to organize the defense, you know, against a team of predators. Mm-hmm. Now we've got a they're going to treat it like a raid, and so we've got a five predator team coming in, and so they're like, well, what do we do now?
Right,
they've killed all the bear in the area.
Right,
the CGI animals were bad too.
They weren't great.
Yeah.
I've seen worse, but they weren't great. I thought it was interesting how she went into the beaver dam to hide from the bear. That was kind of cool. I wouldn't have thought of that. I don't know where the beavers were, because they probably wouldn't have been too excited about her being there, but just gone after her with her teeth, you know, or been scared themselves.
The predator scans the beaver.
Yeah.
Teeth, sharp. Kills it.
It's
a weapon.
Yes, exactly.
Well, Amber Midthunder's weapon is her talent.
Yes.
So I hope that maybe she'll get a couple more action movies off of this or something.
I bet she will. I think that would be great. I mean, they do say at the end of the movie, oh, we have to move. So I don't know how far they'll move.
Like the village?
Yeah, she says, she's like, you know, it's not safe here because the predator and also the
Voyagers. I killed a bunch of white men.
Yeah. So we should go somewhere else.
Yeah.
So we're safer.
All right. So. Well, Prey, you get a chance to see Prey.
Mm-hmm.
It's available now on Hulu. We don't transition out.
No.
We're not doing any transitions this show. So
no.
That's it.
That's it.
That's the end of the show.
Bye.
And the end of me talking for probably the next 4 or 5 days.
Yes.
I'm going to be completely quiet and I'm going to just cuddle up to my new girlfriend. Actually, she's not new. We are getting back together after a long absence.
Okay.
And her name is Aloy Crappy Pants. Because I bought that dumb game, Horizon Forgotten West, a long time ago. And then we got into the summer and cons and all kinds of work on the show and the network. And I haven't been able to kill any robot dinosaurs and watch a redhead with dreads go, oh, okay, I'll do it.
I guess I'll do it.
Oh, boy, I should be able to use these parts to kill dinosaurs. So looking forward to that. Horizon Zero Dawn movie would be good, right?
Yes.
Cast it.
Oh, you would ask me that.
Amber Midthunder is Aloy.
Oh, okay. Sure, you could do that. I was thinking the red-haired actress from Stranger Things, maybe, could do it too.
I don't remember her name.
I don't remember her name, but she's a really good actress too.
And her character's kind of like, oh, yeah, whatever. She's like already ready to do it.
There you go.
So just get, you know, give her a bow and
Yeah.
Good to go.
Yeah.
Let's Photoshop her a giant dinosaur behind her. Actually, I'll just do that.
So there
hold
you
on,
go.
Click. Get Photoshop open here. I won't do it on the air, though. But thanks for joining us. I really do hope that you had a great convergence. And it's really great to see that the show is coming back.
Mm-hmm.
After the fire, the growth returns.
That's right.
And the forest grows stronger.
Yes.
And so hopefully it will continue to grow. I'm sure that it will. If you want more of the Just Enough Trope podcast or any of the programs on the Just Enough Trope network, you can follow us on Twitter, Facebook, and Instagram at Just Enough Trope. We also have a Discord, and I will make sure to remind myself to put a link to our Discord in the show notes.
Yeah, that's
a good
idea.
So if you are a fan of nerdy properties or like talking about nerdy stories, you can join us on our Discord. No bar to entry, doesn't cost you a thing.
Mm-hmm.
Come talk with us about nerdy topics and explore many of the other shows on the Just Enough Trope Network.
Yes.
I don't usually do this, but anything to say?
Anything to say?
Yeah. I just gave my little benediction. You want to say anything about Convergence 2022?
Yeah, it was fun. I was really grateful that I got to do a Sailor Moon panel. I haven't seen one in years past.
Yeah.
So, it's always fun to talk about Sailor Moon, so it was fun to talk about Sailor Moon with other Sailor Moon fans.
Yeah.
You'll
have to do 31 years.
Yeah.
Next year.
If they'll let me. So, yeah, that was a lot of fun. and looking forward to next year, except not spending money on cosplay. So I'll be the one in the duct tape.
I'll work on her. We'll get it done. Don't worry.
Yeah.
Patreon.com/justinotro. That's it for our show. Have a good rest of the 2022 if we don't hear from you, but we hope you continue to follow us and listen to our show, Just Enough Trope, and the other shows in the network. And that's it. I'm signing off. I'm your host, Caliban.
I'm your co-host, Mika Hanna.
Keep the geek fires burning.